privilege to talk about my passion. And it's a passion because it's personal. My brother and my son both have dyslexia. My mother tried to get him the help that he needed. And I did the best that I could for my son, who is now 24, 25, right?
Excuse me, could we possibly close the door?
Oh, sure.
We are permitted, I believe.
Yeah, okay. Thanks, George. I wish someone, when I was trying to educate my son, would have been able to tell me what was wrong and how I could help him. So I hope to answer those questions tonight. So let me start my journey by introducing you to my family. I've been married to my husband, my wonderful husband, for 25 years.
Good answer.
I have four children. My son is the eldest, and I have three girls. Two of my four children have dyslexia. I have an undergraduate degree from Drexel University, and then I decided I wanted to go back to school and get my master's in special ed. So I tell you that because although I had my master's, I was not prepared to teach my children. I didn't know what to do. Tonight we're going to talk about the myths of dyslexia, because they're out there. Warning signs, solutions. One of those solutions is the Orton-Gillingham program, and then if we have some time, I'd love to answer your questions. Oh, okay. So, first thing I'd like to do is to help you understand what it might be like for somebody who has dyslexia to read. So this is a code. I'm going to have you read about seven sentences. So let me ask you, how long do you think it might take you to read seven sentences? You just...
A minute.
Okay. About a minute. Yeah, they're not too long. So I'm going to give you a passage in a few minutes. And every time you see a Q, you're going to pronounce it as a D or a T. And every time you see a Z, it's going to be pronounced as an M. A P is going to be pronounced as a B. And a B is going to be pronounced as a P. You can see when you see a YS, you're going to pronounce it as ER. An A as in fat, so that would be the short sound for A. You're going to pronounce it as E. An E is going to be pronounced as A. All right, we're all on the same? Okay, everybody got it? All right, let me give you the reading assignment. And since my husband is here, and like just keep it over, and then what we're gonna do, since he's here, I'm just gonna have him time a minute. I'll have you turn it over, and he'll give you a minute. George, would you like one?
Sure.
Hi.
Oh, it's okay.
Alrighty. Okay. And your name?
I'm Erin.
Erin, hi, welcome.
Hi.
And let's take a pause here for a minute. That's okay. It's a small group tonight, which is wonderful. And what brings you here tonight?
My 10-year-old is a terrible speller, mm-hmm. So I don't know if that is a thing. Mm-hmm. Because he's a good reader. Yeah. He has a great vocabulary, but his spelling, his phonics are on point, but it's just, I don't know.
Interesting.
And sometimes he does write letters backwards.
All right. So. And how old is he?
He's 10.
10. Okay. Double digits. Okay. All right. So welcome.
Thank
you. Glad you're here. So, all right. Ready? Turn it over. I'm going to give you about a minute. See if you can follow that code. Thank you. Is it a minute?
It's getting there.
All right.
About 10 more seconds, 13 more seconds.
Okay.
All right. There you go.
How did you do? How was that task?
Challenging.
Right.
Yeah.
You did pretty good, Robin. I give you a lot of credit. It's awesome. Did you want to try to read it or?
I'm gonna read it.
You can look at it. I'm gonna read it.
Yeah.
We begin our trip at a familiar place, a body like yours and mine. It contains 100 trillion cells that work together by design, and within each one of these many cells, each one that has DNA, the DNA code is exactly the same, a mass-produced resume. So the code in each cell is identical, a remarkable but valid claim. This means that the cells are nearly alike, but not exactly the same. Take, for instance, the cells of the intestines, that they're vital is certainly plain. Now think about the way you would think if those cells were the cells in your brain. So, someone with dyslexia, well, let me ask you this. When you think of dyslexia, what comes to mind? Yes, just
impaired learning.
Impaired learning, good.
Writing numbers and letters flip-flopped.
Okay.
Maybe that's not it. That's on here.
Yeah. No. There's no right or wrong answer. I'd like to hear what comes to mind. So just, yeah. Anything else?
Stalled, delayed reaction or response.
Okay, so slower processing. Okay.
And I have found that it's not only in reading. My husband and I went and took dance lessons before my daughter's wedding to be able to dance, and he couldn't do it because the backward left, right, back, which I never thought about that, and it was so frustrating for him because he thinks he's a good dancer, which he is when he's just moving, but to have to follow steps left, right with somebody else, it was horrible. I felt so bad.
Yeah. So that's an excellent point. We're going to talk about that because you don't normally think that would be a difficult task for someone with dyslexia. So let's talk about the word. It's a Greek word. Greek words have Y and PH in the middle. That's something you learn if you're in the reading program that I teach. Dys means difficulty with, lexia means language. So dyslexia is an inherited, that was something new, condition. That's something new that I didn't know as a someone who earned their master's in special ed, that makes it difficult for a smart person to read, write, and spell. Before we talk about all the facts, I just want to be really clear that what we're going to discuss tonight is research-based. They're not my opinions. The facts are independent, scientifically replicated, based on research by the National Institute of Health. So let's talk about some myths. First myth, it's rare. So I have to tell you, I remember reading in one of my textbooks about dyslexia, and it said dyslexia is found in less than 1% of the population. But that's not the case. Does anybody want to take a guess on the percentage of people that have dyslexia?
I'd say 40.
40. That's almost half. Okay? Anybody else?
One out of 150.
Okay. All right.
It depends on if the vaccines that the preservatives they put in vaccines, it can affect many things when they get vaccinations and inoculations.
Mm-hmm. Okay. So, the percentage is 1 in 5. That's 20% of our population. So let's say you're I'm a classroom teacher and I have 30 kids in the class. Six of those kids will have dyslexia.
Now I have a question with that number. So is that diagnosed? Does that take into account that children that do have dyslexia but they don't know?
Mm-hmm. Well, the reason why they're able to come up with that percentage is based on what they call functional MRIs. So everybody knows what an MRI machine is. In the 70s, the MRI machine was invented, so they were able to actually see what was happening in the brain.
Wow.
And so we're going to get to that.
Okay, I'm sorry.
And I'm going to, that's a really good question. I'm glad you're thinking. And don't hold back if you have questions. So my point is, it's not rare. It's 1 in 5. People with dyslexia see things backwards. That is not true. They see things exactly the way you see things. It's not a vision problem. If 20% of the population saw things backwards and they're out driving, it'd be a problem. Right? So that's the first myth. If they don't see things backwards, it's a neurological issue. So it has to do with the brain and what's happening in the brain. So let's take a look at the brain. Okay, we have a left side of the brain and we have the right side. The left side is where language is processed. So when they put those individuals in the MRI machine and they had them reading, what they noticed is the left side of the brain was responding. There was lightning, there was spots on the left side of the brain that was responding as they were reading. That's a non-impaired person. Then they put a person in, an adult that was not able to read, write, and spell. And they noticed when they were reading in the MRI machine, the right side of their brain was processing the language, which means that information had to go up. Many times it gets stuck in the frontal lobe and it had to go over to the left side of the brain to get processed. That takes a lot more time. So reading is choppy, it's not fluent, and it affects their ability to spell, write, and decode. So it's neurological. The other thing is people with dyslexia have a little bit larger right brain. So they, yeah, that's a plus. And the strengths of the right brain you can see. One of the strengths is the ability to have a three-dimensional spatial strength. I'll have to tell you a story. I had a student come in. I tutor in the lower level of my home. And I was passing along a piece of furniture. The mom had a minivan. And she was trying to get the piece of furniture in the back of the minivan. She goes, I can't get it. So I got my husband, great husband, comes out. He tries to get the piece of furniture in the back of the minivan. He goes, Dad, no, they're gonna have to get a truck. The student says to me, can I go look? She's 9. She goes and looks and she says, if you move it this way and tilt it that way, it might. Three-dimensional spatial abilities, very strong. In addition to other things, they are creative, artistic, they're visionaries. Yeah. Walt Disney, dyslexic. So, now remember, these are smart people. The language just has to move from here to the other side. And the good news is the brain can be rewired. It's soft, it's pliable, and it can be rewired with the right program. Okay, so it's not seeing things backwards, it's neurological, it has to do with the brain. Okay, another myth. My child can read, so they can't have. Myth. Let me show you what happens. One of the basic skills to be a reader is having what we call phonemic awareness. That's the first skill before someone even reads or does what we call phonics. Phonemic awareness has to do with the with listening and sounds, even before you look at print. So it has to do with our ears. Phonics has to do with our eyes, what we read. So someone with dyslexia has a very difficult time with phonemic awareness. If you say the word cat, they can't pull out the three sounds that make up cat. I'm not even talking about looking at it, just listening to it. If I said to some, a five-year-old, how many sounds are in cat? They would probably say to me, one. They can't pull the sounds out. That's called phonemic awareness. Without that basic skill, phonics is not going to work. So you have to build their phonemic awareness. Let me see, I think I have a talk a little bit about it here. Phonemic awareness, the ability to hear and manipulate sounds in a one-syllable word in your head. It's essential for pre-reading skills. Phonics will not work if you don't have phonemic awareness. So there's a little girl that has a little, she talks a little bit about this. Let me see if I can, I love this.
Lovely is the sound of rain, but seldom is there found anything more important than the sound of a single letter. Anonymous.
Beauty is the sound of birds, lovely is the sound of rain. But the sound of... let's go back.
Beautiful is the sound of birds, lovely is the sound of rain, but seldom is there found anything more important than the sound of a single letter. Anonymous.
And that's what somebody who has dyslexia, they have a difficult time hearing those individual sounds. So, how do they read? Your son reads. How are they reading if they can't hear those sounds? So in kindergarten, first and second grade, typically you have one syllable words, similar to this. Someone with dyslexia will look at it and say, okay, what does that look like? Remember, spatial abilities are really strong. They're gonna look at the shape of the word because they can't hear the sounds. They're looking at the shape. Okay, so then they're reading, they're smart. They're reading, they're hearing their peers read, they're reading about a cat and a dog and pets in a family, and all of a sudden they have to read and they come up with, there's the word they have to read. What are they going to read? Looks like the same shape, right, as this? So they're going to guess, and it's going to be, they're going to guess cat. More than likely they're going to be right because there's pictures in these phonics books, right? And they're smart and they have great auditory comprehension. Yes. And that works for kindergarten, first, second grade. And then third grade comes. And now the word shape changes. Now we have to read multisyllabic words and they can't guess anymore. And that's why third grade is usually the time when you see a big discrepancy now between their reading levels. Okay, so that's what happens in a younger student. But I want to show you what happens in an older student. I had a mom come to me. Her daughter was entering sixth grade. She was receiving reading support throughout elementary school. She might have had an IEP. She was ready to go into sixth grade, and the school told her that she was reading on a third grade level. Mom was very upset. So they put her in a reading comprehension class. Because sixth grade, right, now you're not learning to read, you're reading to learn, and they don't have, you know, the phonics program anymore. So they put her in a reading comprehension because she couldn't understand what she was reading. So they came to me and I gave her three quick assessments. We were together for about an hour. I said, let me see if we can pinpoint what's going on here. So I gave her a spelling test. In the spelling test, it had real words. These are one syllable words, real words, nonsense words, and then I gave her sight words. But right here is an example of her, the real words and the nonsense words that I gave her. She got 10 correct of the real words, 10 correct out of 18, so she got 55%. And then the nonsense words, she got 2 correct out of 14. Let's look at some of the spelling mistakes. First word I asked her to spell was theft. She got the TH. She couldn't identify the short sound A. She used an A. She knew there was an L and an F. And it looks like she was switching them because she can't hear the sounds, right? But she visually knew that there was an L and an F.
Not an L.
Oh, I'm sorry.
And a T.
Sorry, a T. Sorry. Thank you, babe.
No problem.
Thank you. There's my name. I asked her to spell smash. She got that one. Swift. She got the S. She wasn't sure about the, she couldn't hear the W. Wasn't sure about the type of vowel, and then she put a T, she put it next, and then the H. The next word I asked her to spell was throb. She got the TH, she has a B, she got the O, and then she just stuck an E on the end. This is very typical. They don't understand the purpose of an E, they just think it looks right. She got French, and she even capitalized French. I asked her to spell gruff. She got the blend, she didn't get the vowel. This is a sixth grader. These are one syllable words. She got the two Fs, so she understands that spelling rule. I asked her to spell skit. She forgot the K, she knew there was an I, T, and there's the E. Let's just put it on the end there. So you can kind of, after I gave her this, I was like, wow, I don't think she's hearing the sounds.
No.
Then I gave her nonsense, because with nonsense words, there's no memorization. You just have to hear the sounds and spell them. So here are the nonsense words. I asked her to spell keb. She's getting her A and A mixed up. She got the B, she got the K, and then we're just adding an A. Clid she got. I asked her to spell gask. She got the G, the A, the S. And I think that's a T and then a C. So I asked her to spell prack. She spelled it brock. Again, short vowel sounds, having a very difficult time distinguishing between them. Pack for brock. I just want to point this out. Notice B and P. It's not that she's seeing those backwards. It's a directionality issue. She can't remember which way the belly of the B goes. She can't remember if the P goes up or the stem goes down. The B, the stem goes up, but the P, the stem goes down. So we teach our kids, you always have a B with you. It's right here, and you can see which way the belly goes, and you always have a P. So if you have the B and you have the P, you'll know about the Q and the D. And it's physical, and they can see it and they have it. But it's directionality. It's not seeing things backwards.
It's the same thing that children, the B and the D.
Exactly.
Because the belly is
in a
different direction.
That's right. So and many times, children will use capital letters so that they don't have to think about which way the B goes. The B goes in the same direction as the D, and they don't have to think about the direction of that belly. So when you said that your husband was having a hard time with directions left, right, it doesn't surprise me. Mm-hmm. Because that is one of the characteristics of someone who has dyslexia. It's a directionality issue. It's neurological. So, she got most of these wrong. She can't hear the sounds. She's really working hard. She's trying, but she can't hear the sounds. This is a sixth grader. She's had a lot of years of formal education. She got most of this test wrong. So then I gave her another test. I gave her a sight word test. Sight words don't follow any of the rules, the phonemic rules. If you hear a book, you put a B. Sight words, you just have to memorize them because they don't follow those rules. How do you think she did? Any guesses?
A little better.
Yeah. Oh, wow. Sight word test. She got most of them right. Mm-hmm. She got an 88. Mm-hmm. How is this student reading? Is she reading because she knows the sounds of the letters?
Yeah,
she's
memorized.
She has memorized to read. She has memorized to read. Remember, these kids are smart. They're going to figure it out. They're going to compensate.
Just a quick question.
Yeah.
Why did they permit this child to, there's so many, I'll be 70 October 13th. And
look fantastic.
At that time, you know what they did to students that could not read? They beat them. They hit them.
Yeah.
That's how I learned how to read. Smacked across my mouth.
Yeah.
So why did they permit this child?
That is such an excellent question.
Did she come from a public school?
Oh, public school. Very close to this, not, you know, a wealthy district. We're not talking about West Philadelphia here.
I mean, they have counselors, they have readers, they have specials, they have this, they have that.
So we're going to talk about what really... No. That's an excellent question. And that's why I do what I do. Yeah. So it was very clear to me. Should she be in a reading comprehension class?
It's not a bad
no. Because if someone read a story to this sixth grader, she would be able to tell you all the details. Children with dyslexia have very strong oral comprehension.
Wow.
Very strong. So one, for example, when my children were tested on the test. They call them neuropsychs or educational psychs. They're like 20 pages long. They give an IQ test, and then they give usually an academic piece to it. On there, auditory reading, very high. Reading, very low. When you see a big gap between those two, you have to wonder if they have average intelligence. Why can't they read when they can listen and comprehend very well? So that is usually a sign that there's a phonemic weakness. Okay, so that was Abby. So clearly, just spending a few minutes with this student, I could tell she wasn't hearing her phonemes and she was probably dyslexic. So what are some of the other signs? We're gonna go through a lot of signs. You have to have at least three of these for you to say, I think we should look into this a little bit further. Oral speech. What do I mean by that? Let's define it. Speech delays, usually even before formal education. Many of my students receive speech therapy. They mix up sounds when saying words. Buzzsprout, aminal, stuttering. A lot of times they have a difficult time pronouncing the M's and N's and R's and L's. And sometimes they have a hard time just retrieving the word. Mom, can you get me the, Mom, you know what I mean. Auditory discrimination. Let's define that. Auditory memory size. A lot of times they can't remember a name. They can't remember how to spell their name. They can't remember an address. Their processing is a bit slower. Remember, it has to move from the right to the left. They can't hear the differences between sounds, and their phonemic awareness is weak. Reading. They can read a word on one page, but won't recognize it on the next. They won't try to sound out an unknown word, and their reading is slow, choppy, inaccurate, and they're guessing. So let's look at some reading mistakes. These are typical. Let's see if we can figure out what this child's doing. They read house for horse, girl for grill, form for from, and could for cold. What are they looking at? You already know this, we talked about it. They're looking at the what of the word.
The shape.
Yes,
of
exactly,
the word.
You got it, Robin. They're looking at the shape of the word and they're guessing. They see the C and they see the shape.
Oh.
And they're guessing. Second type of reading mistake. They read who for how, stop for spot, felt for left, was for saw. They see it's all the same letters in the wrong order. They're guessing. They know. They're like, I've seen that word before. I've seen a W and an H and an O. Can't remember the order. But they read need for needed. They're leaving off endings. They just read the beginning. Many times they leave out functional words like A, the, at, and all. Sometimes they just make substitutions. They're reading something and it's horse, but they're going to say pony or pony for horse. So they're your typical reading mistakes. And then written expression and spelling is very difficult. Let's take a look at that. They usually have a hard time with capitalization, punctuation, spelling, common word and letter confusion. Sometimes they have an odd pencil grip. And their written expression does not equal their intellectual level. So let's look at, I have an example here.
How would they possibly hold the pencil?
Oh, so many different.
How
do you hold it?
Like this?
Oh my goodness.
My children.
So does my 10-year-old then.
Yeah.
And the teacher did correct it?
If she did, I didn't listen.
She didn't smack you?
That looks like a fun way to write.
Yeah, exactly.
Yeah, I don't see anything wrong with that.
Sometimes that's the least of the, you know, issues that we're working on here. If that's where they feel comfortable and we're not dealing with dysgraphia here, because unfortunately it's never just dyslexia. It's dyslexia and dysgraphia, which means difficulty with writing your letters, or dyslexia and dyscalculia, which is difficulty with numbers, or speech, or it's usually ADHD. Unfortunately, it's not just dyslexia. So I think what's next is, here's a writing sample. So this little guy is going, it's the end of second grade. He's going into third grade. Let me read to you in case you're not used to reading someone who has dyslexia, they're writing. I will do my reading better. Mom and Dad will help me. Reading will help me when I grow. So end of second grade. So maybe he's seven. So let's look at some of these mistakes here. Let's look at capitalization. He capitalizes the I. He capitalizes the M in mom, the M in me, and the W in when. Does he understand capitalization? What is he doing?
Beginning of each sentence, maybe.
The beginning of each line.
I mean, yeah.
Yes, is that what you meant?
Yeah,
yes,
sentence
he's
line.
Capitalizing
yeah.
The beginning of each line.
But why would he capitalize M in my if it's something at the beginning of the word, of the line?
Oh, you mean it right here?
Yeah.
Okay, but he was like, what? I don't think I need to capitalize it. It looks like he started to do a capital. Then he erases it and he realizes, I don't need to do that. I'm going to put a small m. Let's look at other. He doesn't capitalize the R. And I think that was it. So he's confused about capitalization. He thinks it's at the beginning of every line. Let's look at punctuation.
He's got his period.
He's got his period. Isn't that good? Yay. We're happy about that, right? Let's look at reversals. Let's look at dad. It looks like remember, it's much easier to write capitals because they both go the same direction. So it looks like he started with a capital D here, maybe a capital D, but maybe a P. He erases them. He decides that I don't want to do the capitals. He does small, but they're going the wrong way. Is this little guy working? He's working really hard.
Really hard.
Really hard. Any other reversals here? Okay, let's look at some spelling. Reading. He doesn't understand how to spell in. He's going into third grade. That's a very common suffix. And then if you take ing off, he doesn't understand that a closed-in syllable is a short sound. That's a very basic. Closed syllables make eh, not e. He doesn't understand that. He doesn't understand that when you have a two-syllable word, better, you need two vowels. Every syllable has a vowel. He doesn't understand that. Spelling help. I don't understand the why. He was consistent, but he has all the right letters in the wrong. He has these two reversed. He has them in the wrong order. Again, he probably saw it, memorized it, but now he can't remember what order because he doesn't have the phonemic strength to sound it out. Eh,
ooh. But why does he have a Y?
Yeah, I don't know. I don't know why. He has one here and one here.
That sounds like putting that E in there. That.
Yeah, like an E, yeah.
Did you know this particular student?
No.
Because, my goodness, how much did the parents work with him? I mean, I'm just curious.
He goes to school. I mean, so he was in school. He was getting instruction. He got formalized instruction in kindergarten, first grade, second grade. This is the end of second grade. When, that's a very common sight word. And then he doesn't capitalize the I. So clearly he has dyslexia. You can see it in the writing sample. And he's working really hard.
That's what makes me really sad about this, because he's trying to figure out how he can learn to do that.
Yeah.
It's just... Yeah.
Well, listen. You're here for a reason, and you're here because you have information now that's going to be able to help other people. And with the right program, the kids we work with are the hardest working kids that I know. They want it. They want it. Gail's one of my tutors. How about it, Gail? Mm-hmm. Work hard. And when you expose them to the program that works with the right side of their brain, they're like, I can learn. I can learn. Because
how old? Like, do you have to be young? Like, could my husband learn this program?
I have a 34-year-old male who comes to me.
He's older than that.
I know, but I'm just giving you an example. It's never too late.
Because
it's never too late.
If I could just give you a scenario of if they're not help, you know, like everybody says, and especially what you described, you'll understand this. He thinks because he has voice now, for text messaging,
right.
It's a whole new world for him.
Yeah.
What he doesn't know is he is sending those messages out to people. And I started going to him, do you read these? And because it makes no sense. And I would get texts at work and I'd go, well, we're either having lobster for dinner or, you know, because it was not, but as you explain, it's okay for him to say it, but if he doesn't know what's right and what's wrong, he's reading that the same way and going, looks good to me.
Right.
That's what I wanted to say.
Right.
So that, I never thought about that. I go, Ken, you're sending these things out, and he goes, well, I said it, and I put it in there.
You gotta check.
It doesn't always.
Yeah, but he can't even check.
Right, right.
Because I said,
yeah.
You're sending, you, I said, this is what this says.
Yeah.
Well, that's not what I wanted to say.
Yeah.
But he can't read it.
Right.
Oh my gosh.
So yeah, but so there is, listen, there is hope. I'm here not I'm here to show you what it looks like, but I'm also here to talk to you about where what's effective. So let's just talk about one other thing that is difficult. difficulty with memorization. So and these are common things. Some of our kids come to us and they just have a hard time with spelling their names, remembering and spelling their address. Can't remember the days of the week, months of the year. It doesn't mean they can't learn it, but this is a sign that they're processing on the right side of their brain. So fortunately, my brother, who has severe dyslexia, his name is Lawrence. Well, that wasn't easy, right?
My husband's middle name. He has never been able to spell his middle name, ever.
I remember being in elementary school, listening to my father try to help my brother spell his name without understanding that he had dyslexia, without either one of them understanding. And the wonderful thing, when kids come into our center, we're able to tell them that you are gifted. You have strengths. And you can read with the right program. It's 80% of the population reads with traditional reading programs, and schools are going to use the traditional. So there's nothing wrong with you. And unfortunately, what happens is when you're in kindergarten, first and second, and until you get to third grade and they start testing you, some of the kids could start saying, you know, what's wrong with me? Because Joey's getting, I'm not. I have to work three times as hard. What's wrong with me? And there's nothing wrong. You learn differently, and you need a different program. Actually, you have more brain than the 80%. So that's the first thing. We educate our students on how they're gifted and strong. So I was a passionate mother with two that had dyslexia. I didn't know what to do, so I tried all these programs. So I'm going to show you what programs do not work. I went to the library, and I got hooked on phonics. If they have no phonemic awareness, remember the sounds, they can't do phonics. These don't work. However, and when I heard this, I was a bit upset. In the 1930s, there were two doctors, Dr. Orton and Dr. Gillingham, noticed that there were these intelligent adults that couldn't read, write, and spell. Mm-hmm. And so they took it upon themselves to start working with these adults. This is before the MRI. And they came up with a program that was effective in teaching these adults to read. Here's Dr. Orton, Dr. Gillingham, 1930. So this program that I'm going to share with you tonight has been around for a long time. What makes it work? It's multisensory. It's not just letters on a piece of paper. You're using your voice, you're manipulating tiles. The tiles are different colors. You're saying it, you're hearing it, and you're touching it. The program we use is very systematic. It's explicit. I'm gonna explain to you the rule, and I'm gonna tell you the exceptions to the rule. Because our students do not read, they don't learn from reading, because they can't read. So we have to explain every rule, decoding and encoding rule to them. And then they need intensive practice. And then one rule, once they learn these rules, they can move on to the next set of rules. That's the weak thing. And so over time, we've been using these techniques and they work. They work. These are Orton-Gillingham programs that work. So many of the public schools are using Wilson, Project Read, and so, and I use the last one, Barton Reading and Spelling. So you have to know, you have to educate yourself, and you have to say, because there's a lot of programs out there, you have to say, is this scientifically proven to work with somebody who's processing on the right or has dyslexia? Don't just buy into any program. Yes.
Is there one that, in this list, all of these are acceptable programs
yes.
to be using? Okay.
Yes.
There's not one that's...
No, we're good. Okay. No,
these
are all these
the
programs that are Orton-Gillingham. So Orton-Gillingham is the umbrella. That's the methodology.
That makes more sense. Thank
that's
you.
The method, and then underneath
yeah.
the programs. There is a program, I think, that is called Orton-Gillingham Reading.
I feel like I read that somewhere, but
yeah.
very
yeah.
cool.
But that's what you want. That's what you're looking for.
Okay.
Okay, so the program I use, just to give you an idea, there are 10 levels, and you can see how detailed it is. The first level, we're not even putting print in front of the student. We are working with sounds, pulling sounds out, blending sounds together. So we're strengthening that phonemic awareness. Then we move into letter sound association. Then we talk about closed syllables. And then we teach very specific skills on decoding. You come across a word you don't know, how are you going to figure it out? And we give them very specific ways to do that. So it's very, and the system is skill-based, not grade level. So notice, when they get to level 6, that's the first time they're getting exposed to silent A. How many primary readers have silent A in them? There's a whole book on silent A. And they need to know all those rules about silent A, so they don't just put it on there. We don't want them guessing. We want them to have confidence that they know why they're using it.
That was interesting. Influences of foreign languages.
Yeah, so let's talk about that for a minute. So, let's see, I brought my board over here.
Oh,
okay. Yeah, I'll give it back to you. So, these kids, you know, they're not going to get it from reading. You have to teach it to them, right? So, we teach this digraph, CH. It's two letters, but it makes one sound. It makes the sound, ch, right? So, they practice it. They spell using ch, ch, ch. Then... we don't introduce this until we get to foreign languages, but then we get to a word like this. This is hard for my students. What sound is the CH making? Because it's Greek. And then we see that word. What sound is the CH making? They're not just going to get that. They have to be taught that. And since we came from England, and England was conquered by France, and then France conquered England, so we have a lot of words in our language that come from Latin, Greek, France, and England. So we teach it. And then this is probably my favorite level, because we don't teach Latin, but many of our words come from the Latin. So there are words that we use, like this word. This is Latin-based. And then we teach them, we can put this on the beginning. Commit. It doesn't say commit. It says commit, because that changes to schwa, and it's a chameleon prefix. And then if I wanted commit T, then they learn how to write the endings to that. But it's all based on Latin roots, and it helps them to spell. And my students get it. I had an 8-year-old student. I said, I want you to go home, and I want you to tell your mom why two of those A's say uh. Because all along we've been saying A says ah, ah, apple, ah, ah. Why do two of those A's say uh? They say, oh, Mrs. Service. There are open A's that aren't accented, so they turn to schwa. 8 years old. Because all they needed to do was be taught it. They're not going to get it from reading. Because that's not the way their brain works. But they were able to tell me that rule. And so when they learn to break up into syllables, oh, that's an open A. It's not accented. It's going to say, oh, like you're getting punched in the stomach. They love the physical. They love. So, they're smart. They just need to be exposed to the right method. So I just want to expose you to a little bit of our rules, if you'll allow me. One of our first spelling rules that we teach is the floss rule. I always go, you floss, auntie. Your floss rule. So now
they don't start dancing the floss.
Oh yeah, I have a student. I can't do it, but they did. One of my students did
only
the floss.
Kids can do it. It's like a hula.
I know, and you know about it. Your husband probably could do that one. So this is a spelling rule, because the one thing that's difficult for somebody who has dyslexia is memorization of random facts. So if you send them home with a list of 10 words and you say, I want you to memorize them so you can take the test on Friday, they will spend hours trying to memorize those words. They will take the test, maybe pass it, and then forget all those words the next day or the next week. That doesn't work for their brain. But if you tell them the rule, then they'll be able to spell a lot of words. So random facts do not work. But if you teach them the floss rule, which says if a word has just one vowel, so it's going to be a small word, and ends in F, L, S, or Z, we couldn't fit the Z in there, double it. You double those letters. You double the F. You double the L. You double the S. If a word has one vowel and ends in F, L, S, or Z, you double it. Can anybody think of some words?
Boss.
Boss. Staff. Class.
Oval.
No, what? That has two syllables in it, George. One syllable, just short little.
Off.
Class has one syllable, has one vowel. Off, one vowel. Staff, one vowel. Jazz, one vowel. Now they have it. They can spell a lot of words. And not only do they have a lot of practice on that, we integrate the spelling with the reading. So now the reading passage is going to have floss words in it. So we're integrating it. It's not a separate subject. And so there's connection. Because if you teach somebody with dyslexia, if you connect language and logic, they're going to remember it. Tell me why. Why do I double the S? Because it has one vowel in it. And if the word ends in F, L, S, or Z, then you're going to double it. Tell me why, and then I'm going to be able to remember it.
Yep.
Bringing logic to language. All right, so we not only teach the rule, we teach the exceptions. There are three words that do not follow that rule. So this type of automobile takes our kids to school.
Bus.
Why?
Come from another language?
You're on the right track. It's short for omnibus. And that's real. I had to look it up. I was like, are you kidding? Really? There's a license plate that says omnibus.
Yes.
That is short for bus. That is short for omnibus, bus. What do you put in a bus to make it go?
Gas.
Why?
Gasoline.
That's right. It's short for gasoline. So now you're connecting a Y. One more. Can everybody read it?
Yes.
Yes! Are you looking at it like that? Did I spell it wrong?
Yeah, I'm trying to figure out why it's...
Because it's short for yes or rebob, and I made that one up. All right. So, but see,
they'll remember that.
They won't remember it, right? So, we teach the rule, we teach the exceptions to the rule, and there are a lot of exceptions. And that's why this program, Orton-Gillingham, is not a quick fix. If anybody tells you, oh, 2 months your kids are going to be reading on level, that's not going to rewire the brain, especially if a child's been guessing for 2 and 3 years. We have to rewire them and give them the confidence that they don't have to guess anymore. So that's one of 112 rules that we teach them. And they can get it.
They do get it. Like we've learned, you know, I before E, et cetera.
Yeah.
C, sounded it.
Right.
And
right.
We remember that.
Right.
I still do that.
Right.
Like, okay, oh, is it? But there's exceptions.
Right. Do you know I before E, except after C, is very rare? Make sure. That doesn't work on many words.
I know.
But we all remember it.
I know.
Because there's like a little tune to it.
Exactly. But I'll go, wait a minute. No. Einstein would have really messed up like that.
Do you know he was dyslexic? I have a poster of him in my center.
I knew that.
Dyslexic.
So
Walt
smart.
Disney, dyslexic.
I didn't know Walt Disney.
George Washington.
Yes.
Dyslexic.
We just have to have more children singing in choirs, seeing the syllables into words into sentences. It worked for me.
And that's...
And puzzles, putting puzzles together.
Well,
so
that's that visual, spatial visual. I could give my son a box of Legos, and he would create something that I could never... create without directions, because he had that multi-dimensional strength. So we have to tell them about their strengths, because they're hearing about and dealing with their weaknesses.
Yes.
So let's talk about where you're strong.
Yes.
And we're going to get this. You're going to get it. All right. So that's a spelling rule, but let me expose you to a reading rule. After using this program, I didn't realize how much C was a real trouble sound and letter. Here's one of our reading rules. C makes two sounds. It makes the k sound, right? But it also makes s. Does anybody know when it makes the s sound?
Like session.
Okay.
When it's followed by E, I, or Y.
Oh, how do you know that, Mom?
Because we homeschool and we use all about spelling.
Okay.
I looked up and it is this, so I'm relieved.
Okay. Amen.
So,
good. So,
yes.
So, E, I, and Y are watch out vowels. You need to watch out for them because they will change the sound of the C to a S. So, they learn those watch out vowels. E, I, and Y. Let me see what I had here. So these are some examples, right? They're not going to just get this because they can't read. So we have to teach them when there is an E, I, or Y, it's going to boss the C around to say S, like it's cycle, cinch, and scent. But if it's not a watch out vowel, it's going to say its most common sound, which is K. And so we teach them that. They have a chance to practice that intensely and read it. Now, that can also affect, I'm going to show another spelling rule when you're thinking about the sound that the C makes. That can affect spelling. So, this is another spelling rule, kiss the cat. Most of my boys are like, ah, ew, ah. But it helps them to remember it. Spell k with a C whenever you can. When are you not going to use a C? There's a hint down there.
It has a
I mean, there's a watch out vowel, right? If I want to spell kiss, can I put a C there?
No,
because
it's a watch out.
That's right. The watch out vowel's going to boss the C around and say S. So you have to use a K. You're looking at me, Colleen. Do you get that or no?
Yeah, I feel like I need to retrain my brain.
I know. I realize.
I can read.
This is hard, but not. This is when the light bulb starts going off in these kids because they're not taught this way. They're not taught this way. So let's do a little exercise here. Oops, sorry, I'm going the wrong way. So I want to spell keg. Am I going to use a C? Nope, why? There's a watch out vowel there. I can't use a C, so I'm going to use a
K.
Clump. Can I use a C? Because you're going to use C whenever you can.
Yes.
Yep. Kept.
Nope.
Can I, no,
watch
why?
Out vowel.
Watch out vowel. Three watch out vowels.
E, you said them. What would it be?
I
and
why.
Very good. Skit. Can I use a C there?
No,
because
watch out vowel.
That's right, you got it. So you see, so we give them an opportunity to practice that. Then read it. Write it. And then they get it. Because I'm giving them the rule and the logic behind it. I'm not just saying go memorize these words. Okay. So that's a good thing. And it works, and it's effective. And I've seen little guys and big guys, little girls, big girls, come into my tutoring center, come in with their head down.
Oh.
And for the first time, they're like, I can learn. So let's just talk a little bit about, I don't know where you guys are, but in school, like you homeschool, which is a gift to your kids, because you can go at their pace. But these are some accommodations in school that you can ask for. A simple one like this: please don't call on my son or daughter. Let them volunteer.
Yeah.
Teachers don't think about that. Teachers are in that profession because they care and they really love teaching. But they don't think about that when it comes to somebody who struggles. And some kids are really anxious. They have stomach aches. They don't want to go to school because they don't know what's going to be required of them and how it might make them feel in front of their peers. So just a simple thing like that. Don't take off for their spelling, because they'll only write words that they can spell, which won't match their intellectual level. Allow technology, as long as you check, right, Robin? Like, there's iPads now, there's dictation software, so it can take the pain out of having to write every letter, and they can get their ideas. So there's some great. Copying is very difficult for somebody with dyslexia. So don't make the copy. Have a buddy, have them Xerox a buddy's notes. Audiobooks are wonderful because our children learn, they read auditorily. They read through listening. There's instead of this way, some people read by touching, breath. So, and they're usually stronger in their ability to read and understand than you and I who read print. So audiobooks are a gift, because until their reading level can catch up, until they can catch up, by listening to audiobooks, they can enhance their vocabulary and enrich it by listening to really good literature. Give them extra time. Remember, their processing is a little slower, so they need a little extra time. Read the questions on the test. Let them give them an oral test. Let them explain it instead of them having to read it. So there are great accommodations out there. We have to be the advocates for our children, and we have to educate the people around our children who are educating them.
I like that last one, pre-writing. Yeah, graphic organizers. Yes. Yeah, I use that a lot.
Yep, that's visual, right? It gives them a starting place. If you tell someone who struggles with writing, here's a topic, write.
They don't know where to begin. You've got to give them a you've got to give them the steps. And there's a great program out there called IEW, Institute for Excellence in Writing, which is very similar to Barton in its methods.
What is it, IEW?
IEW, Institute for Excellence in Writing. And there's testing accommodations. Give our guys a little more time. Read the test to them. Redo some sections. Only maybe, if the test has 10 questions and they answer 5 because it takes them longer, correct them. Just mark the 5. Don't mark the ones they didn't get to.
No.
Because it takes them a little bit longer. Don't, what's the word? Yeah, don't, what?
Penalize.
Yeah, penalize them because they're slower at reading. So many times I sit with my parents, we'll write these accommodations down, and then they'll bring them to the teacher, and many teachers are very accommodating. Okay, so websites. Write Solutions for Dyslexia. The woman that wrote the Barton Reading and Spelling Program is an advocate for people with dyslexia. There's a lot of information on her website. And then this is my website.
Are you local?
I'm in Westchester.
And what do you charge? Is it my first semester?
I'm sorry. No, that's all right. So, you can call me. We can talk about it.
So, and do you work in any of the local schools, with the local schools?
So, I have had parents come to me, because, you know, these kids work hard. They come to me, if they go to school, they come to me at 4 and 5 o'clock. They're exhausted.
They're spent, yeah.
So, one family said, we would pay you to go in, and during his language arts block, we would like you to teach him using this system that works best for his brain, and the public school would not allow me to do that. However, I've just been hired by a family to go into a private school during that language arts block and pull that student and work with them, and this school was very accommodating and gave me a room. They want to learn what I'm using because maybe it'll be beneficial for other students.
But I think some of the schools are using this.
So let's talk about that. Wilson is used in the Westchester Area School District.
We just started Wilson today.
Okay. In public school?
In public school.
Okay, so this is the thing you have to be careful about.
Are you in Phoenix?
Mm-hmm. Dyslexia shows itself on a continuum of mild to profound and in between. If a student is the student probably has to be at least 2 years behind to have an IEP, to be pulled out to be in a small special ed class. So now I have 5 or 6 students in my class as a special ed teacher. Let's say they all have dyslexia, sometimes not, sometimes autism, sometimes another issue. And I have a 40-minute reading block. I have to close the 2-year gap. Well, my goal is to close that gap with 5 or 6 students in my class who all have varying degrees of dyslexia. This child can't say their short vowel sounds. This child is able to read 2-syllable words but is having problems with decoding. This child has difficulty with dysgraphia and writing. I'm going to do the best that I can as a special ed teacher, but it is unlikely that I'm going to be able to close that gap with 5 students in my classroom. They do the best that they can, and even with an Orton-Gillingham program, it's hard to do that.
Or one-on-one.
Excellent.
Yeah.
So that's what you need.
Good news.
That's what you need. Mm-hmm. You need a one-on-one who's going to specifically deal with the issues of that child, because see, our kids can't make up 1 year. they're already 2 and 3 years behind. So the question to ask is, how are you going to close the gap?
And it's coming up because they're supposed to be able to read at level at third grade. So going into fourth grade, if they're not there, that's what you were saying, like they've gone through first, second, third, and it's at that fourth grade level that people are going, whoa, wait a minute, what happened?
Yeah. So that's very hard to do, and I don't know anything that can be as effective as one-on-one intensive Orton-Gillingham to close that gap. That's where we're at.
Look, yeah, but he's in second. He just, but he's eight. So
yep.
He started a year later. But he just started.
He's in second, okay.
We're behind. I just want to show a 2-minute video. Can I do the 2-minute video? And we'll, this will be the end. This was a student who was starting, I think, fourth or fifth grade, and she wrote a letter. She wrote this to her teacher.
Like a small boat on the ocean, sending big waves into motion, like how a single word can make a heart open. I might only have one match, but I can make an explosion. And all those things I did say were wrecking balls inside my brain. I'll scream aloud tonight. Can you
child or husband. because that really explains the whole brain thing in a very understandable way. So, I know we went over our time. I'm so sorry, George. Thank you so much.